This unit contains information about how to write a good scientific paper. A lot of tips given for oral presentations are also applicable here. Science is storytelling. However, a paper should be more precise than a talk and encompass all the details of your research. No paper is expected to be the ultimate scientific breakthrough. Rather, summarize and discuss your contribution in a clear and logical way. Remember that science needs to be understood, so explain each of the steps you have taken as understandable as possible. Make sure that the reader can retrace your line of thought. A good paper should be complete in its story, so avoid having gaps in your argumentation and don't presuppose specialized knowledge from the audience. Give all the information the average reader will need to understand your paper. On the other hand, only include necessary information and relevant content. This is a very fine line to walk. Be as precise as needed, but make your research as accessible as possible. You can assume general knowledge of the topic, but don't spare details that are essential to make your point. Try to start your argumentation by describing the broader context of your work, and then derive from that the details of your research. The contents of a paper in computer science are often structured in a very similar way. A paper starts with the title, the authors, and the abstract. Then, the introduction outlines the problem the paper is trying to solve and provides a short summary of the solution. It is followed by 2 to 5 sections of content. First, related work is described to give an overview on the scientific context of the paper. Then, the method or approach the paper is taking to solve the problem at hand is explained. The application of this method is described in the experiment part of the paper, where results are given too. Finally, the conclusion completes the paper and explains the insight that can be derived from the experimental results. At the end of the paper, references are given, citing all the work you made use of throughout the paper. Sometimes, appendices are included too, which contain extra materials that do not fit the main body of the text. Sections are numbered, usually with one level of detail. So you might have subsections 2.1 and 2.2, but not subsections like 2.1.1 or 2.1.2. If present, those are usually unnumbered. There always should be some text at the beginning of a section. Do not immediately begin with the next subsection, but rather include some primer on what the section is trying to accomplish and how it is structured. Make use of the common headings: introduction, related work, method, data, experiments and results, and then the conclusion. Section headings should be as concise as possible. However, don't shorten headings to the point where they can be misleading or misunderstood. The first part of any paper is the abstract. It provides a very short but sufficient summary of the high-level structure of the paper. An abstract is usually between 5 and 10 sentences long. One approach to formulating an abstract is to split these 5 to 10 sentences and allocate a special function to each sentence. The first sentence should be about the motivation and the context of the paper, so describe where this paper is situated in the larger body of work that already exists for this topic. In the next sentence, describe your problem at hand and why this problem has not been addressed before. Based on that, you provide the main questions that will be addressed in this paper. Between 2 or 3 sentences are then allocated to describe the approach this paper takes at solving the problem, followed by 1 to 3 sentences, depending on how long the paper is, giving the highlight results of the paper. Essentially, an abstract needs to shortly answer the following questions: what is the problem? Why is it a problem? What is your solution? And why is it a solution? The introduction can be seen as an extended version of the abstract. It provides more detail and tells the whole story from context to conclusion. While the abstract should be understandable for nearly everyone, the introduction can be more in-depth and require some existing knowledge from the reader. Still, the introduction talks about the paper on a high level, just enough detail to give information for readers that got their interest piqued by the abstract. And the content section is where all the nifty details of your research are explained. It elaborates on all the aspects of the existing literature, your method, and your results. It can be much more technical than abstract introduction, and expect readers to be acquainted with the specific field of study you talk about. The conclusion is the counterpart to your introduction. It summarizes all the work done retrospectively and gives an outlook on possible future extensions and applications of your work. Scientific writing has a very unique style that is different from normal text. It should be as clear, concise, and unambiguous as possible. A common misunderstanding is that scientific writing needs to be complex. On the contrary, scientific writing explains concepts in the simplest, most exact way possible. Use the impersonal or we form rather than the I form, even if you are the only author. Avoid pronouns with unclear references and use explicit discourse markers, words such as because, however, or while. Do not use language blurring or sentences that are open to interpretation. This includes words like maybe, potentially, or probably. Try to keep your sentences short and to the point. Have one statement per sentence, and have at most one sub-sentence explaining why this statement holds true. As soon as you can split something into two sentences, just do it. A highly recommendable resource for scientific writing is a great book, Writing for Computer Science by Justin Sobel. Sometimes you cannot convey your ideas through text only. That's where tables and figures come in. Similar to our presentations, visual information is a great way to communicate complex issues. Figures and tables are numbered consistently throughout the paper, meaning that the numbering does not start over for every section, like you would, for example, do in a thesis. In tables, avoid placing vertical lines. No text in tables or figures should be larger than the main font of your paper. Also avoid font sizes that are too small and difficult to read. Captions are placed above for tables and below for figures. They contain explanatory text on what the figure or table is about. If you use technical terms throughout your paper, explain them shortly the first time you use them. Don't overformalize it though. If you established a term, don't use synonyms, stick to it consistently throughout the paper. If you introduce acronyms or abbreviations, give the full text once and then consistently use the acronyms from there on. Introduce an acronym only when you are going to use it multiple times, otherwise it will just create confusion. Footnotes are reserved for secondary information. They have reduced readability and should not be necessary to follow the argumentation. Don't cite literature using footnotes. That's where in-text citations are for. Speaking of citations, a citation is an in-text reference to a bibliographical source. There are many different styles of citing literature, for example, acronyms, author year citations, or numbered sources. What style to use is usually defined by the style guide of the venue your paper is intended for. You should cite everything that is a reuse, a paraphrase, a summary, or translation of content from other people's work. As a rule of thumb, always clarify where a piece of information originated. What is your idea, and what is taken from elsewhere? Better cite too much than too little. Keep in mind that you also need to cite yourself. If you directly reuse a span of text, put it in quotes and mark any added or omitted pieces as editorial note inside square brackets. The source is given after the citation. For indirect reuse, like summarizations, give the source close by, either before or immediately after the text in question. For larger text passages or whole paragraphs, the source is commonly given once in the beginning. Everything you cite should be included in the references at the end of the paper. They contain bibliographical information about every single source you gave in the text. Here, two different styles are possible. Give at least the year, author, and title of every source. For conference publications, also provide the proceedings the publication comes from, with page numbers. For journal publications, include number and volume of the journal and pages of the paper. For books, publisher and, if applicable, the edition. For online sources, give not only the URL, but also an access date. A good practice for using online sources is to archive a copy of the website in the Wayback Machine. Finally, a note on plagiarism. Plagiarism is the act of selling other people's work as your own, either on purpose or by omitting proper attribution. It is not a trivial offense and can have consequences. Major cases can lead to the denial of publication or grading. In minor cases, it still negatively affects the grade or review outcomes. Keep in mind that Webis actively conducts research in the field of text reuse.